Boa noite, Brasil. Boa noite, mundo. Mais uma vez, Hangout ao vivo. Eu, Fernando Betete, juntamente com o Dr. Lair Ribeiro. E hoje um convidado especial que você vai saber daqui a pouquinho. Mas hoje a gente vai ser bastante breve, nós vamos ser bastante objetivos, porque o assunto que nós vamos falar hoje é de interesse, que eu posso dizer, para a maioria absoluta das pessoas, porque eu acho que em cada família brasileira, em cada família mundial, existe uma preocupação com uma doença no órgão chamado coração. E é sobre esse tema que nós vamos trazer as novidades mais importantes da cardiologia. E queria mais uma vez, para você que está conhecendo o nosso trabalho, fazer a apresentação do nosso convidado aqui de honra, que é o Dr. Lair Ribeiro. Ele é formado em medicina há mais de 45 anos, ele é cardiologista, mestre em cardiologia pela PUC do Rio de Janeiro, ele é nutrólogo pela ABRAM e Associação Médica Brasileira. O Dr. Lair Ribeiro morou durante 17 anos nos Estados Unidos, período em que trabalhou em três universidades americanas: Harvard Medical School, Baylor College of Medicine e Thomas Jefferson University. Nesse período também exerceu os cargos de diretor médico da Merck Sharp & Dohme e diretor executivo, alcançando a vice-presidente da Ciba Corporation, hoje Novartis. Autor de mais de 100 trabalhos científicos publicados em revistas médicas americanas indexadas. O Dr. Lair Ribeiro também publicou mais de 38 livros, sendo 15 deles best-seller, 26 traduzidos para outros idiomas, e hoje disponíveis em mais de 40 países. Por mais de 20 anos, proferiu palestras em diversas cidades brasileiras, vários países da América do Sul, Central, América do Norte e também na Europa. Treinou mais de 4 mil médicos brasileiros na área de adequação nutricional e otimização da homeostase. Atualmente, o Dr. Lair Ribeiro é professor de pós-graduação do Uningá, Centro Universitário Ingá, instituição avaliada pelo MEC em 2017 como quarto melhor centro universitário do país. Hoje, então, meus amigos, é uma data especial e eu já vou passar a palavra aqui para o Dr. Lair Ribeiro falar um pouquinho do tema que vai ser abordado hoje, que é cardiologia metabólica e o médico que introduziu esse conceito na área médica, na área de cardiologia, Dr. Stephen Sinatra. Mas antes de passar a palavra para o Dr. Ribeiro abordando esse tema, os nossos agradecimentos para a nossa rede de profissionais que compartilham esse sinal. O Wilmar, do canal Mioctateno, o Ricardo Grum, canal Minha Saúde e Curas Naturais, o Júnior Alac, Medicina e Saúde, o Moisés, o Saúde e Bem-Estar, o John, da John BTV, o João Dapper, da Nutrição, Alimentos e Companhia. Meu muito boa noite em nome da Academia Lair Ribeiro e do Dr. Lair Ribeiro. Do Facebook, o Éden Faria, Grupos em Busca de Pensadores, Augusto Cury, Capixaba da Gema, Utilidades Capixaba, também um Facebook muito visitado. O grupo Mundo das Ideias, do Dr. Lair Ribeiro, Jéssica Nunes, a Carol, a Priscila, o Lázaro Mazonete, a Bruna Alves, o Maurício Silva. E também ao nosso amigo Luiz Sartorelli, grupo Instituto Lair Ribeiro e seguidores do Dr. Lair Ribeiro. Então, mais uma vez a todo esse grupo, nosso muito boa noite e obrigado por formar essa rede que vai alcançar aí milhões e milhões de internautas brasileiros. E aqui eu já deixo o convite também para você acessar o Instagram oficial do Dr. Lair Ribeiro, @drlairribeiro, @drlairribeiro, minúsculo, tudo junto. Dr. Lair Ribeiro, muito boa noite. As suas palavras em relação à cardiologia metabólica e Dr. Stephen Sinatra.
Boa noite a todos vocês. Eu hoje não sou protagonista. Hoje aqui estou só para fazer a introdução. A grande estrela da noite é o Dr. Stephen Sinatra, com mais de 20 livros publicados, com mais de 300 trabalhos científicos publicados na área de cardiologia. Falando de cardiologia, é uma enfermidade relativamente moderna sofrer do coração. Você tem uma ideia? O Dr. James B. Herrick, em 1912, um médico americano, descreveu pela primeira vez o infarto agudo do miocárdio, que era uma raridade. Ninguém sabia disso. Tanto é que ele publicou em 1912 e ninguém prestou atenção. E ele foi obrigado a republicar em 1919, 7 anos depois, chamando a atenção. Em 1930, morreram nos Estados Unidos em torno de 3 mil pessoas com infarto agudo do miocárdio. Em 1960, morreram 300 mil. O que que fez ir de 3 mil para 300 mil em 30 anos? Duas coisas ocorreram. Primeiro, em 1911, foi lançado nos Estados Unidos o Crisco, que era um óleo cristalizado de algodão, pela Procter & Gamble. E houve uma grande propaganda em parar de usar gordura animal e parar de usar óleo de coco, que era o que as pessoas usavam para cozinhar. Esse foi o primeiro problema, porque esse óleo Crisco, para não ser rançoso na gôndola do supermercado, ele tinha que fazer um processo de hidrogenação parcial. E ele ficava, virava gordura trans. Então, foi o primeiro contato que nós tivemos com a gordura trans, trazido pela tecnologia. E a gordura trans, como nós sabemos hoje, é um veneno. Então, esse foi o primeiro veneno. Nesse mesmo período, o consumo de açúcar aumentava. Você tem uma ideia, em 1700, nos Estados Unidos, ingeria 2 quilos de açúcar por pessoa por ano. Em 2010, 80 quilos por pessoa por ano. Então, aumentou 4.000% nesse período. Então, você junta a gordura trans dos óleos vegetais que você compra no supermercado com o grande consumo de açúcar, esses são os dois principais fatores desse aumento de hoje você ter como doença cardíaca como a principal causa de internação hospitalar. E a principal causa de morte na maioria dos países no mundo, tá? Mostrando a gravidade do problema. Em 1948, com a preocupação que eles tinham tá aumentando a doença cardíaca, eles criaram um estudo na cidade de Framingham, que fica a 40 milhas de Boston, em Massachusetts, e até hoje esse estudo epidemiológico continua, e foram determinados os fatores de risco de Framingham. E entre eles surgiu essa história do colesterol. Só que, para vocês terem uma ideia, mais de 50% dos pacientes internados hoje no Brasil com infarto têm o colesterol normal. Vou falar de novo. Mais de 50% dos pacientes com infarto agudo do miocárdio internados nos hospitais brasileiros hoje, nesse momento, têm o colesterol normal. Então, essa teoria não explica nem 50% dos problemas. A Framingham identificou vários outros fatores de risco, como, por exemplo, a pressão alta, a hipertensão. Hoje nós sabemos que, se você pegar uma população com mais de 65 anos de idade, 65% dessa população tem pressão alta. Se eu pegar pessoas com mais de 77 anos de idade, 77% dessas pessoas com mais de 77 anos tem pressão alta. Então, hoje é uma somatória de vários aspectos, vários riscos. Mas aí, nesse ínterim todo, surge essa figura, que é o Dr. Steven Sinatra, que era um cardiologista normal, membro do American College of Cardiology, hemodinamicista, fazia cateterismo e tudo mais. E ele começa a estudar a influência da nutrição no coração. É uma coisa que nós, cardiologistas, não nos preocupamos muito, porque a cardiologia é muito hemodinâmica, é muito física, é quase que um engenheiro. Um cardiologista, ele olha a bomba cardíaca, o fluxo, como se fossem uns canos e tal, é como se fosse um sistema de hidráulica. Então, nós temos um pensamento muito matemático, muito de engenheiro nessa dinâmica toda. Mas o Dr. Steven Sinatra, com a criatividade dele e com a inteligência dele e com o bom senso dele, ele começou a perceber que existiam alguns nutrientes que faziam a diferença. E ele foi fazendo pouco a pouco. Ele começou com coenzima Q10, depois ele foi para carnitina, depois ele foi para o magnésio, depois ele foi para ribose. E finalmente ele fechou um estudo que ele chama de solução de Sinatra. que ele começou a ensinar na cardiologia e começou a recuperar pessoas. Então, ele tem histórias fabulosas de pacientes que estavam na fila de transplante cardíaco e que começava a solução de Sinatra e saíam da fila de transplante. Nós, aqui no Brasil, vivenciamos isso também. Então, isso fez uma diferença muito grande, porque a fila para transplante cardíaco é enorme e não existe coração suficiente para transplantar. E chega uma fase da pessoa que ela não tem jeito de fazer mais nada a não ser fazer um transplante. Pelo menos era assim antes do Steve Sinatra. E a mesma coisa acontecendo com a cardiopatia congênita, que a criança nasce com um problema cardíaco e entra em falência e morre. E tem alguns tipos de doença que é uma congênita que a própria cirurgia não consegue resolver, exigindo, às vezes, transplante cardiopulmonar, que não é feito nem no Brasil. E tem que ser uma pessoa, uma criança com mais ou menos o mesmo tamanho, né, e que compatibilidade imunológica, etc. Você vê que a coisa fica praticamente impossível e tem que ir lá na Europa ou ir lá nos Estados Unidos para fazer isso. Bom, ele começou a fazer isso, ele começou a ter sucesso, ele passou a publicar mais. Como eu disse, ele tem se você olhar no Amazon.com, ele tem mais de 20 livros na cardiologia publicados e ele tem mais de 300 trabalhos científicos publicados em revistas médicas americanas indexadas. Então, é um privilégio a gente poder assistir essa entrevista. Eu congratulo o Fernando Betete por ter essa ousadia de procurar o Dr. Steve Sinatra, conseguir marcar uma entrevista com ele, sair daqui do Brasil, ir até Tampa, na Flórida, entrevistá-lo e editar essa entrevista, que vocês vão adorar, e tudo isso vai acontecer daqui a pouco. Fernando, com você.
Obrigado, muito obrigado, doutor Lair, pelas suas palavras e agradecer aqui publicamente a abertura, né, que o senhor está fazendo aqui. Eu sei que o senhor tem uma legião de seguidores e de fãs e, logicamente, está trazendo mais audiência para essa importante entrevista que o senhor mesmo teve a oportunidade de assistir anteriormente e o senhor também elogiou o conteúdo dessa entrevista. Mas, meus amigos, eu vou ser bastante breve. Eu conheci o Dr. Lair há cerca de aproximadamente 7 anos e eu sou jornalista profissional na área da saúde. E quando eu fui entrevistá-lo, eu tive a oportunidade de perguntar sobre a minha filha Priscila. A Priscila hoje ela tem 15 anos, mas quando eu conversei com o Dr. Lair, ela tinha cerca de 7 anos. Ela é portadora de uma cardiopatia congênita extremamente grave, que nem o doutor Lair falou. A única indicação para ela era transplante cardiopulmonar. Durante os 7 primeiros anos da vida da Priscila, eu não tinha outra alternativa a não ser a seguir a medicina tradicional, né? Só tinha esse caminho. Mas como pai, eu não aceitei isso e fui procurar alternativas. Quando encontrei o doutor Lair Ribeiro, ele me diagnosticou a Priscila sem nunca tê-la visto. Ó, tua filha tem isso, ela está tomando isso. Acertou em cheio, eu lembro disso como se fosse até hoje, e falou: olha, se você me permitir, eu posso ajudá-la com uma suplementação de um médico americano que tem feito um bom trabalho e tem ajudado muitos cardiopatas, que é o Dr. Stephen Sinatra. E de lá para cá, a vida da minha filha mudou por completo. Hoje, a minha filha, ela continua com a doença anatomicamente errada, tá? Mas ela tem uma vida clinicamente cardíaca normal. Tanto é que ela atravessa a piscina embaixo d'água. Os médicos, quando veem isso, não aceitam isso daí. Às vezes, quando eu tenho que levar alguma consulta de rotina, que o médico vê a Priscila pela primeira vez, ele fica com medo só de auscultar o tipo do som que sai do coração da Priscila. Mas nesse tempo todo, também convivendo com o Dr. Lair Ribeiro, eu aprendi muito a importância da palavra gratidão. E nesse entender o que é gratidão, eu tinha como missão, jornalisticamente, como pai da Priscila, o meu desejo era entrevistar esse médico, o fundador desse conceito, né, da cardiologia metabólica, o Dr. Stephen Sinatra. Exaustivamente, eu procurei agendar essa entrevista com ele. Demoramos também cerca de 6 meses, mas conseguimos, tá? Vou resumir aqui, porque eu sei que vocês querem ver a entrevista, muita gente tá querendo assistir essa entrevista. E ali eu cumpri o meu papel, agradecer pessoalmente um médico que desenvolveu esse conceito e essa fórmula, e no Brasil somente o Dr. Lair Ribeiro conhecia isso, porque eu passei por todos os médicos, os principais centros médicos cardíacos do Brasil, eu como pai desesperado, não queria que acontecesse de nada de mal com a minha filha. Em 5 minutos de conversa com o Dr. Lair, ele me apresentou a solução de Sinata e transformou a vida da minha filha da noite para o dia. Foi muito bom conhecer essa suplementação e as orientações do Dr. Lair Ribeiro. E aí eu cumpri o meu papel de ir para Tampa, entrevistar o Dr. Stephen Sinatra e agradecê-lo pessoalmente. Ele se comoveu com a minha história, se comoveu com a história da Priscila, deseja conhecer a Priscila e pediu a minha autorização para colocar a história dele no blog, no site dele lá nos Estados Unidos. Logicamente, eu autorizei, porque a missão dele, e ele também falou que é a minha missão a partir desse encontro, e eu sei que é também do Dr. Lair, é divulgarmos esses novos conhecimentos da medicina para o maior número de pessoas, né? E está até escrito na Bíblia: conhecereis a verdade e a verdade vos libertará. Eu conheci tive acesso a um novo conhecimento através do Dr. Lair Ribeiro, que tinha acesso a essas informações todas, né, da medicina mundial, e ele me deu gratuitamente, e eu não poderia ficar com esse segredo guardado. Eu também estou fazendo o quê? O máximo possível para divulgar para outros pais e para outros profissionais de saúde, que não é fácil aceitar essa informação, que existe sim um outro caminho possível de tratar determinadas cardiopatias. Queria agradecer a sua audiência e, a partir de agora, então, assistam conosco essa entrevista feita em Tampa com muita dedicação, com muito carinho, com o Dr. Stephen Sinatra sobre cardiologia metabólica.
Olá, tudo bem? Minha missão aqui hoje é muito especial. Estou aqui para lhe apresentar uma entrevista feita pelo jornalista Fernando Betete com o renomado cardiologista norte-americano Dr. Stephen Sinatra. O Fernando Betete é o pai da Priscila e nunca aceitou que sua filha, para sobreviver de uma cardiopatia congênita, tivesse que viajar para o exterior a fim de se submeter a um transplante cardiopulmonar de altíssimo risco. Fernando Betete veio me entrevistar em 2012, depois de 6 meses de insistência, para seu programa de televisão. Ao final da entrevista, ele mencionou sobre o problema da sua filha e solicitou a minha ajuda médica. Eu disse para esse pai desesperado que só havia uma solução que não fosse cirúrgica para Priscila, que seria ser colocada no protocolo de cardiologia metabólica do Dr. Stephen Sinatra. Esse protocolo consiste no uso de 4 suplementos e é conhecido como Quarteto de Sinatra. Após 6 meses no protocolo, Priscila foi levada para um follow-up de rotina e os médicos ficaram muito surpresos com a melhora, tanto clínica quanto dos parâmetros hemodinâmicos avaliados. Hoje, 6 anos depois, Priscila não faz uso de nenhum medicamento alopático, segue tomando o Quarteto de Sinatra e leva vida normal. Fernando Betete, em um ato de agradecimento, decidiu localizar o Dr. Sinatra e foi entrevistá-lo em Tampa, Flórida, Estados Unidos. Dr. Sinatra é um cardiologista muito conhecido mundialmente, autor de mais de 12 livros sobre cardiologia, sendo um deles Cardiologia Metabólica. O que vem a seguir é a entrevista feita ao Dr. Sinatra. Espero que você saiba reconhecer a sabedoria desse gigante na medicina. Aproveite!
Olá, amigos. Chegou o grande dia. Aqui está o pai da Priscila e o jornalista Fernando Betete entrevistando o Dr. Stephen Sinatra e nós vamos falar sobre cardiologia metabólica. Para quem não me conhece ainda, a minha filha nasceu há 15 anos atrás com uma doença muito grave que necessitava de um transplante cardíaco pulmonar. Eu não aceitei esse diagnóstico dos médicos e fui atrás de uma solução. Nessa minha caminhada, encontrei o médico Dr. Lair Ribeiro no Brasil, expliquei o problema da minha filha e ele me apresentou um suplemento chamado a Solução de Sinatra. Usei a Solução de Sinatra com a minha filha. Em 4 meses, ela mudou a saúde completamente para melhor. Há 8 anos, ela usa a Solução de Sinatra e tem uma vida completamente normal. E hoje é uma honra e um prazer estar aqui na cidade de Tampa, nos Estados Unidos,
Viajei durante 9 horas, mais de 9.000 quilômetros, para estar aqui com o Dr. Stephen Sinatra. E vamos conhecer então um pouco agora do Dr. Stephen Sinatra, esse homem iluminado que recebeu esse dom divino de ajudar as pessoas através da cardiologia metabólica. Dr. Sinatra, muito obrigado por o senhor estar recebendo a gente aqui para falar um pouquinho da sua vida, do seu trabalho e da cardiologia metabólica. Quem é Stephen Sinatra? Antes do Dr. Stephen Sinatra, um pouco da sua história familiar e por que escolheu a medicina.
I started a career in medicine because of my mother. My mother, when I was 8 years old, was a brittle diabetic. And when I used to come home from school, sometimes I would find her on the floor in a coma. So as a young boy, I always lived in fear that my mother was going to die. So in order to save my mother, I decided to become a doctor. So when I attended college and went to medical school, I became very interested in metabolic medicine.
Ok, mas antes de o senhor continuar falando sobre esse assunto, no Brasil, o médico se forma após 6 anos de faculdade e ainda tem uma residência médica obrigatória com média de 3 anos de duração para se tornar um especialista. Como é a formação médica nos Estados Unidos?
Sure. In the United States, we had 4 years of college, and then 4 years of medical school, and then 1 year of internship, and then after my internship, I decided to do 2 years of internal medicine residency, and then after I took the boards, the American Board of Internal Medicine exam, and became a board certified internist, I attended 2 more years of specialized training in cardiology. So when I was about 31, I started to practice medicine after a long time.
Por que escolheu a cardiologia e como era o seu dia a dia no hospital e consultório antes de perceber que a alopatia e os protocolos tradicionais não estavam ajudando seus pacientes? Como que o senhor se sentia como médico ao ver que os resultados não eram satisfatórios?
That's a very interesting question. I chose cardiology because I liked the action of emergencies. In college, I was a wrestler. I was a Division I wrestler, and we wrestled at a very high level, and I liked competition. The combination of my college and the wrestling actually enabled me to get into medical school, which was at the height of the Vietnam War in the United States. I always thought I was going to Vietnam, but I guess God had another place for me. So I went into cardiology, worked with a lot of emergencies, saved a lot of people, unfortunately lost people, but I felt that cardiology was for me. And then I realized that the heart is a very complex organ, but it's very sensitive to very common nutrients. And I learned at an early age, for example, I've been using coenzyme Q10 for more than 30 years, that this particular vitamin-like substance is vital, vital for the heart.
Quando e o que foi que aconteceu que o fez despertar para iniciar um novo caminho de tratamentos diferentes dos tradicionais protocolos médicos aceito nos maiores e mais respeitados centros médicos do mundo?
It all happened by accident. When I was introduced to coenzyme Q10 over 30 years ago, I had a young woman the same age as me who had a baby, and she developed postpartum cardiomyopathy, which is very rare. She was in heart failure. She went from doctor to doctor. She was dying, waiting for a heart transplant. She saw me. I put her on coenzyme Q10, doubled the dose every 3 weeks, and it was a miracle. She started to sleep through the night, was able to walk across the room, care for her infant child, and now she's 73 years old.
Wow.
She was placed in my path for a reason. I started with coenzyme Q10 over 30 years ago, had her on magnesium, around the same time. 15 years ago, or 20 years ago, I added carnitine. And then after I heard a lecture in Las Vegas in 2004, I added ribose, which I felt was the missing link in the whole concept of cardiac renewal. So it was by accident that I heard another board-certified cardiologist lecturing on ribose, and then it made perfect sense to combine the four nutrients together because it drives ATP, or the energy of life, in a preferential direction in the body.
Para mim, isso não foi acidente. Ok, fale um pouco rapidamente sobre o papel da psicologia em sua atividade médica. Qual o benefício da psicologia nessa área cardiológica?
Well, my training was no accident. When I did a year of internship, I did not match in the United States. So I had no place to go, but by accident, my hospital and medical school did not match their psychiatry residency. So they offered me a position to take half psychiatry and half medicine, another accident, but maybe no accident, maybe orchestrated by spirit, where now I was introduced to mind-body medicine. My interest in psychiatry then led me into more training in Gestalt psychotherapy and bioenergetic psychotherapy by Alexander Lowen, where many, many Brazilians attended the conferences. Brazilians are perhaps the second group in the entire world that have certified bioenergetic psychotherapists. So I trained with Brazilians for years, gone to many conferences in Western Europe, and it's been a real pleasure for me because so many Brazilians are now bioenergetic psychotherapists.
Bom, vamos falar agora um pouquinho mais sobre as doenças cardíacas. Dr. Sinatra, de forma mais profunda, quais são as doenças mais comuns do coração e suas causas segundo a medicina tradicional, primeiro?
Oh, that's very easy. Hypertensive heart disease and arteriosclerotic heart disease, which includes heart attack or people with heart cramping or angina, where they may get an angioplasty or bypass surgery, or many are treated with pharmacological drugs, as well as vitamin and mineral and phytonutrient support.
Qual seria a causa disso? Tipo, a hipertensão. Na sua opinião, qual a causa da hipertensão?
The most common causes would be family history, genetics, certainly excessive salt intake, overweight status, emotional stress and turmoil, and some congenital factors as well as endocrine factors like hyperactive thyroid gland, hyperactive adrenal gland.
Agora eu quero saber se essas mesmas doenças cardíacas, na opinião do Dr. Sinatra, têm a mesma causa, ou seja, se o senhor concorda que, com o que dizem os livros e as escolas de medicina, por exemplo, um infarto cardíaco é provocado pelo colesterol alto, hipertensão é provocado somente por sal de cozinha?
There are many factors involved, multifactorial. Heart attack, in my opinion, is caused mostly by very thick blood, with narrowing of blood vessels. Now, there are many causes of narrowing of blood vessels. Emotional stress, too much iron in the blood, too much homocysteine, a small cholesterol molecule called LP little a, and the list goes on. But I believe that traditional cholesterol is only a small contribution to coronary artery disease.
Okay. Para complementar a pergunta anterior, quando uma pessoa morre de infarto e aparentemente tem saúde normal, por exemplo, uma pessoa magra, índices normais de colesterol e triglicerídeos, às vezes é até um atleta, pela sua experiência e estudo, qual seria a explicação para essa morte de um infarto de uma pessoa normal?
Stroke is very similar to heart disease. In other words, in heart disease you can have a plaque inside the heart, and in stroke you can have a plaque inside the brain. And people can have a hemorrhagic stroke if they burst a blood vessel in the brain. And the primary cause of that is high blood pressure.
Agora que já temos um pouco mais de conhecimento sobre o coração e suas doenças, eu gostaria de saber como que foi migrar da alopatia, ou uso de medicamentos tradicionais, para o uso de suplementos nutracêuticos e a mudança de hábitos alimentares.
Good question. First of all, as a doctor, whatever heals the patient is the most important. So sometimes I will need bypass surgery, sometimes pharmaceutical therapy, but many times I can use lifestyle habits, healthy diet, targeted nutrients, grounding or earthing,
yes,
exercise, detoxification, and even mind-body, like Tai Chi, Qigong, prayer, yoga, anything that attenuates the autonomic nervous system and brings the patient into a calmer state.
Agora, o que é cardiologia metabólica e qual a sua contribuição para a cura ou grande melhora das doenças cardíacas e a volta de uma melhor qualidade de vida aos pacientes?
Metabolic cardiology is something that I discovered over a course of 20 years. I've treated thousands of heart patients with diet, pharmaceutical drugs, exercise, mind-body. But I need something more important in getting at the cellular level. Metabolic cardiology drives energy in a preferential direction, and it supports the production of ATP, which I feel is our vital force, or the energy of life. The Japanese call it ki, the Chinese call it qi, Hebrews and Christians call it breath of God. But I feel our qi energy, which I refer to as vital force, is really a reflection of our mitochondrial energy. And this is where metabolic cardiology works. It works inside the cells. And remember this. When it works inside the mitochondria, which is a part of the cell, a third of the entire weight of the heart is mitochondria.
Wow.
The heart has more mitochondria per cell than any other organ in the body, including the brain. So it makes sense. You feed the mitochondria. The mitochondria supports our vital force, our chi. And since the heart has mostly mitochondria, a third of the weight of the entire heart is mitochondria, by driving this energy through the mitochondrial dynamics, people get better. But there's another reason that I discovered in 2009. I was reading a journal that was put out by Scandinavian researchers. And the journal was about stem cell renewal. In the 1950s, for example, when the Cold War was going on, carbon-14 testing was available around the same time that they were exploding experimental atomic bombs in the deserts of Arizona, Nevada, etc. So through the radioactive carbon 14, we can tell the age of human cells. So in this journal article 9 years ago, I had this incredible joy when I read it. With carbon 14 testing, they could determine the age of cells. And I always thought that once you had a heart cell, it couldn't regenerate. I'll say that again, it could not regenerate. We know that the cells in our mouth and our nose can regenerate. We know our red blood cells are reproduced every 120 days after some die, because they live for about 120 days and the spleen takes them out and new cells are formed in the bone marrow. The epithelial cells in the gut can regenerate, but nobody felt the heart could regenerate. All the scientists felt and doctors felt that if you had a heart attack, that area of the heart was dead. Even in medical school when I was young, they said, the professors, that the 5-year survival of cancer was better than heart failure. But when I read this article in 2009, I had this great joy in my body, and I feel it now. I have this vibrational energy. So maybe the angels are telling me I'm correct. But after reading the article, I realized that metabolic cardiology, or the four nutrients, coenzyme Q10, magnesium, carnitine, and D-ribose, which the body makes three of them. If we give these nutrients, the question is, are we buying time for our own intrinsic stem cells to take over and regenerate or revive or revitalize the diseased heart? That's how I feel metabolic cardiology is working. In other words, I feel that there's a link between our own intrinsic stem cells, and we only learned this in the last 10 or 15 years. This is very, very new. But if the metabolic constituents reinvigorate the natural stem cells of the body, I believe, like I said momentarily before, that the heart can regenerate itself. I have had dozens and dozens of patients who have refused heart transplant. They've had massive heart attacks, congenital heart disease like your daughter, and even situations where they've had infectious cardio, what we call myopathy, like myocarditis, and they improved. And I never knew why until 2009 when I read the article. And then another article came out, I have the reference here, in 2017 by the same researchers from Sweden, and they called the article Dating the Heart Exploring Cardiomyocyte Renewal in Humans. And the same mechanism is suggested. And I really believe that metabolic cardiology can buy the patient time for the patient's own stem cells that they got at birth, that are in our fat cells, our bone marrow, and they contain the complex information that can regenerate the heart. But this is only my feeling, it's a hypothesis, but I feel it's correct. And the reason being, I have so many patients that have thrived that should not have. And then when Tommy went to heaven, he learned in heaven that metabolic cardiology was validated by Jesus. It was the greatest moment of my life. I grew up Catholic and I've always believed in Jesus. But meeting Tommy was the most incredible gift in my entire lifetime.
Uma pergunta de curiosidade. Ele disse que 30% do peso do coração são mitocôndrias. Yep. Uma célula normal tem quantas mitocôndrias? Uma célula cardíaca tem quantas mitocôndrias?
Okay. In a heart cell, there are 5,000 mitochondria. In my bicep cell, there are 200.
Muito curioso.
So metabolic cardiology is best for the heart because of the ATP. In mitochondria.
E no cérebro tem quantas?
The brain has lots of mitochondria. I don't know the exact number per cell. The brain, the kidney, and the heart, I believe, have the highest mitochondria in the body.
Ok, vamos falar agora da solução de Sinatra. O que é e quais são esses suplementos e a função de cada um deles? Por favor, nos explique de maneira detalhada a ação deles em cada célula humana. Mas antes disso, gostaria de saber a história de cada um deles, como ele foi escolhido pelo Dr. Sinatra para compor a solução de Sinatra.
Sure. The Sinatra solution includes four vital nutrients. Three of the four are made by the body. Carnitine is made in our kidneys, predominantly. Okay. The ribose is made by cells in the body. In high school biology, we call it the pentose shunt. And CoQ10 is made by all our cells. The problem is when people become ill, many of these nutrients are used up very quickly to thwart off or to combat what doctors call free radical oxidative stress. So most people can make enough nutrient to keep them well. However, environmental toxins, congenital factors, overwhelming high blood pressure, poor diets, chemicals or insecticides or pesticides, and the list goes on and on, can cause an inexorable drain of these vital nutrients. So it's very important that we take them as supplements, given the fact that we live in a toxic environment in the computerized world. And remember, it's not just things we can see that are the problem. For example, the cellular phone and computers and Bluetooth and cordless phone can put out invisible signals that are toxic to DNA. So now the world is worse. We have chemicals, environmental toxins, and now we have an enormous amount of EMF, electromagnetic forces, that insidiously damage our cells. So it makes sense for us to take antioxidants, do a healthy diet, do some grounding and earthing, so we get free electrons into the body, so we can live better in our computerized, increasingly toxic world.
Então vamos começar pela L-carnitina. O que é a L-carnitina? Qual a sua importância? As ações esperadas no corpo e principalmente no coração. Quais doenças cardíacas que a L-carnitina pode ajudar?
Yeah. L-carnitine is very important because it helps transport fat in the mitochondrial membrane. It acts like a ferry boat, where it takes in fat that we eat, and it's metabolized in the cell. And then the carnitine acts like a shuttle. It helps to take the fat into the cell, and then it takes the metabolites, which can be toxic, out of the cell. So we call it a carnitine shuttle. Shuttles fats in, takes toxic metabolites out. And I learned in my early age as a cardiologist, maybe in my late 40s, that carnitine and CoQ10 have a synergistic response. And I started to use them together after I wrote a book on carnitine, and I realized how complementary they are. Because remember, the essence of life, or the breath of God, or the key energy, or the chi energy, is really mitochondrial energy. So coenzyme Q10 and carnitine help to turn over ATP in the mitochondrial membrane. D-ribose, which is made by our cells, is a five-sided sugar. And it's the center of the ATP molecule. So ATP, or adenosine triphosphate, is an adenine ring, ribose, a sugar molecule, and three phosphate groups. It seems complex, but it's very simple. It's the energy of life, because when we do any activity, like my talking now, ATP is constantly being utilized, because the last phosphate group is cleaved off, and that gives me the energy, for example, to talk. We only have 8 seconds in the body. That's why the German war criminals knew that cyanide could be very deadly, because it shuts down the Krebs cycle, and we only have 8 seconds of ATP. So if the Krebs cycle is poisoned with cyanide, you can't function.
Agora quero saber um pouquinho mais sobre o magnésio, o que é, qual a sua importância, ações esperadas no corpo e principalmente no coração. Doenças cardíacas mais comuns em que o magnésio ajuda a tratar ou prevenir.
Magnesium is a vital nutrient. It's involved in over 300 enzymatic reactions in the body. The most common heart problem in the USA, and probably Brasilia as well, is mitral valve prolapse. We know that magnesium and coenzyme Q10 can fix perhaps 80% of the symptoms associated with prolapse of the mitral valve. Perhaps 5% of the population in the USA have mitral valve prolapse, and over time can cause leakage of the mitral valve. But very rarely do people need surgery. Magnesium and CoQ10, in my experience, are lifesavers when it comes to mitral valve prolapse. I would also use carnitine and ribose if my patient did not respond to magnesium and CoQ10.
Qual a relação entre magnésio e hipertensão? Pode ajudar?
Oh, good question. Many, many people are hypertensive because they have low magnesium in the body. I don't know about Brazil, but in the United States, the agricultural soils are severely depleted in magnesium. Magnesium is plentiful in fruits and nuts, but if the soils don't contain enough magnesium, you need to take as a supplement. Personally, every night before bedtime, after I brush my teeth, I take 3 capsules of magnesium, 300 milligrams. It's like brushing my teeth.
Relembrando a pergunta anterior, qual tipo de magnésio é usado na solução de Sinatra?
Oh, I use 4 different types of magnesium in the Sinatra solution. I've been working for a company called Healthy Directions for almost 25 years, and I formulate vitamin and mineral products. And the magnesium formulation that I use is a combination of 4 different types of magnesium. It's an orotate, which I learned from the Australians, at a CoQ10 conference 15 years ago, where magnesium orotate is very special, that it drives ATP in the right direction. It's not readily seen in magnesium supplements in the USA. And I don't know about Brazil, but I like it in combination with magnesium glycinate, citrate, and magnesium taurinate. And then I use the magnesium orotate with the other three, and I call it broad spectrum magnesium. Now, the most common magnesium is magnesium oxide. Perhaps you use milk of magnesia in Brazil. The magnesium oxide stimulates the large bowel, and that's why we use it to get better flow of stool, and why we use it in constipation.
Vamos falar um pouquinho agora sobre a D-ribose. Qual a função dela e o que ela ajuda especificamente?
Well, D-ribose, like I said before, is made by the body. And it's the center of the ATP molecule. So it's very important. And what happens in people with heart disease, any form of heart disease, ischemic heart disease, valvular heart disease, congenital heart disease, is that the ribose is used up very fast, and the body cannot keep up making it. In other words, the body falls behind. Production cannot keep up with the utilization. So there's a mismatch. So in any form of heart disease, you must give the patient ribose. Because if there's not enough, if it's used up, you have difficulty forming enough ATP, which, as I said before, is our qi. It's our energy. So we need to give ribose. Now, if I knew about ribose when I was wrestling in college, I think I would have done a lot better. People in sports, baseball players, football players, long distance runners, a lot of them take ribose because it helps regenerate the energy in the body. And in a patient with congenital heart disease where energy is starving, ribose is very, very helpful.
Ok, agora para terminar a solução de sinatra, eu quero saber sobre a coenzima Q10, o que é e qual a sua importância tanto no coração como para o cérebro.
Coenzyme Q10 is made by the body and it's absolutely vital for life. Coenzyme Q10 does many things. It has a slight blood thinning effect. It's a membrane stabilizer. And the sine qua non of aging, of getting old, is when the cellular membranes have space between them. When the cellular membranes are tight, then toxins can't get in. So what CoQ10 does, it stabilizes the outer cellular membrane. And that's why it's believed to be very useful in anti-aging. The most important aspect of coenzyme Q10 is its bioenergetic effect. What coenzyme Q10 does in the inner mitochondrial membrane is that it turns over and helps to regenerate ATP. So biochemically, in patients with heart disease who need more energy, it makes perfect sense to take CoQ10 because the extra CoQ10 will drive ATP in a direction to create more energy. And energy is the essence of life.
Agora, quem deve tomar a solução de Sinatra? Tem contraindicação? É importante para prevenir doenças? Qualquer pessoa pode tomar a solução de Sinatra?
I think anybody over the age of 40, I've written in my books, should take these nutrients. But coenzyme Q10 is number one. This is the most important nutrient I believe anybody could take. Even healthy people over the age of 40. Recently, I've been thinking about 30 because of the computerized age that we live in. Because coenzyme Q10, not only is it a perfect antioxidant and membrane stabilizer, and helps to thin the blood a little bit, but as I said previously, it has a bioenergetic effect. Since the body makes it, there are really no contraindications. The only problem, and it's very, very rare, is that the blood thinner called Coumadin that we use in the United States has a similar structure to CoQ10. And very rarely, I've only seen it maybe twice in over 30 years of using CoQ10, where if a patient takes Coumadin and CoQ10 together, they get an additive blood thinning effect. But I believe, other than taking Coumadin, and I think 99.9% of people can take it anyway, anybody can take coenzyme Q10. So for me, there's no contraindications.
Vamos mudar um pouco de assunto agora, deixando a solução de Sinatra agora, que já aprendemos um pouco. Vamos abordar agora colesterol. Então, eu quero saber, o que é essa molécula? Qual a sua função no organismo? Precisamos ter medo do colesterol? E qual a relação do colesterol com doenças cardíacas?
Cholesterol is very necessary for the human body. We need cholesterol to live. Without cholesterol, we would die. The problem with cholesterol is that if it becomes oxidized, it can become angry, and then it can create inflammation. However, we need cholesterol to thrive. For example, cholesterol it's needed in our brain to create neurotransmission between neurons. Cholesterol helps to form our hormones, estrogen in the woman, testosterone in the man, and many other hormones as well. Cholesterol lubricates the skin. Cholesterol is vital important for what we call bile salts in the gut for absorption. The only problem with cholesterol is, like I said momentarily, that if it becomes oxidized or angry, it can create inflammation. Inflammation is the cause of coronary artery disease. Cholesterol is a very small player when it comes to atherosclerosis.
É usado um protocolo médico para combater o colesterol, que são as estatinas. Qual o efeito colateral das estatinas?
One of the major side effects of statins is muscle pain and weakness. Sometimes people have difficulty with their legs, they have cramping, they have pain in their legs. I've even had people unable to focus their eyes because of the intraocular muscles. And cholesterol can cause memory problems, particularly in people in my age group over the age of 70. The reason why cholesterol has so much baggage is that it interferes, you know, with the body, in a sense that the same molecule that cholesterol comes from makes the molecule, well, it's the same molecule that CoQ10 is derived from. So if you use drugs to kill cholesterol, you can lower CoQ10 at the same time. I believe in coenzyme Q10. Although some people may need statins, and they may need cholesterol lowering, in any patient I use a statin on, I always give them a couple of hundred milligrams of coenzyme Q10 as well. Simply stated, statins will drive cholesterol down, but they will also kill CoQ10 at the same time, or kill the production of CoQ10. Now, where would I use a statin? In any male, over the age of 30 to 40, and under the age of 75, with proven coronary artery disease. I would use a statin, and I give CoQ10 at the same time. But my belief in using a statin is that it's a tremendous blood thinner. It happens to lower cholesterol at the same time, which in some people is a player in heart disease, especially in the people with the hereditary problems where they have cholesterols of 700 or higher. But I just feel that coenzyme Q10 is so important and vital for the body that when I do give it to males, I always supplement, as I stated previously, with coenzyme Q10. I don't like statins in women. I just have not been convinced that statins really work in women. However, if I had a woman with far advanced coronary disease, angioplasty, bypass surgery, they've done it a second time, she's not getting better, and my back is against the wall, I'll choose a low-dose statin. I do not use statins to treat high cholesterol. I'd rather use lifestyle changes.
Na sua opinião, quais suplementos ajudariam a combater o colesterol?
Well, coenzyme Q10 prevents the oxidation of LDL. That's why I like it. Remember, if the LDL is not oxidized, no problema.
Vamos falar agora de suplementos. Existe uma guerra constante em desvalorizar o uso de suplementos por uma grande maioria de médicos. Por qual motivo existe isso? Por qual motivo isso acontece? Afinal, qual é a verdade ou o real motivo dessa guerra entre remédios e suplementos? Como fica o paciente nessa guerra?
Unfortunately, many doctors do not believe in supplements. Supplements is something that came to me very early in the practice of cardiology. I met a Dutch chemist when I was 31 years old, when I received my boards in cardiology, took the exam and passed, and then I met this 91-year-old Dutch chemist, and he basically taught me about using supplements in the treatment of heart disease. He was an engineer. He refused bypass surgery. And when I spoke to him on the telephone at 91 years of age, I felt he was sort of a visitor or or an opportunity for me to look at non-pharmaceutical therapies or even bypass therapies in the treatment of heart disease. One thing about surgery. If you have a patient that you cannot get well, and you've used lifestyle changes, you've used supplements, you use pharmaceutical drugs, it's time to call a surgeon. If they have the right anatomy to operate on. Bypass surgery, in my opinion, has saved many lives. I think in America, we jump too quickly, though, to bypass surgery. And I use it as a last resort, or if I'm dealing with left main coronary artery disease, where you must intervene with surgery.
Vamos saber mais sobre as principais funções de alguns suplementos. Eu vou perguntar primeiro, então. Ômega 3.
I love them.
Qual a função dele, resumidamente?
Oh, they are good for the brain, they are good for the heart, they're good for your skin, for the retina of the eye. Omega 3. If I was stranded on a desert island and I needed only two supplements, it would be my hope that a few cases of CoQ10 and omega-3s be washed ashore.
Qual a dose diária de uso de ômega 3?
The daily use in amount, like 1 to 2 grams a day.
Uma cápsula, 1,000 miligramas, 1 grama.
Yeah, 1,000 milligrams a day in most people is more than enough.
Vitamina K2.
Ooh, I love K2. Yeah, I learned about K2 from the Dutch researchers. They studied K2 for 30 years. And when I met them in Connecticut 15 years ago, I started taking Metaquinone 7, vitamin K2, because it prevents calcium buildup in blood vessels where it does not belong. I take 300 micrograms every day.
Okay. Vitamina D3.
Vitamin D3 is very good. I love it. I take it. And at least 2,000 to 5,000 units per day. But pues, Brazil is close to the equator. So you should have adequate vitamin D levels in your bloodstream. The closer you are to the equator, the more vitamin D absorption in the skin, providing you have good cholesterol. You need cholesterol and sunlight to get vitamin D into the body.
Qual a principal função da vitamina D3?
D3 does everything good. It's good for the brain. It's good for the bones. It's good for our organs. We are learning more and more about vitamin D, especially in neurology. Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, any neurological condition.
Sistema imunológico também?
Oh, absolutely. D3 is vitally important for a good immune support.
Hoje em dia se toma muito um pool de aminoácidos. Qual a sua opinião sobre isso e qual a importância de tomar o pool de aminoácidos?
Years ago, I thought an amino acid stack, taking at night, could build growth hormone in the body, natural growth hormone. I have veered away from that reasoning. However, there's one amino acid called L-arginine, which can be very helpful to people, because it can help breathe in nitric oxide, which is a very vital nutrient today. Remember, the Nobel Prize was discovered about 16 years ago on nitric oxide, and I believe in the future it's going to be a very important substance to take. So instead of an amino acid stack, if you wanted to take L-arginine, that would be fine. One more important, coenzyme Q10 in the rabbit model has been shown to have a nitric oxide effect. This is very recent literature, and I feel that more information on CoQ10 is going to come out in the future as being even a more miracle nutrient.
Óleo de coco.
Coconut oil? It's okay. There is mixed literature on it that saturated fat can be pro-inflammatory. I personally like coconut oil. I like olive oil more. I think olive oil has much more medicinal impact. And I feel that olive oil is the secret sauce of the Mediterranean diet. I like it much better than coconut oil.
Como que você consome o azeite de oliva diariamente?
The best way to consume it is to drink it. The Mediterranean study showed that 4 tablespoons a day, less neurological disease, less Alzheimer's disease, less diabetes, less coronary heart disease. This is over almost 5 years, 4.8 years, in 7,500 participants in the Mediterranean study. Over 7,500. The Mediterranean diet has been written up in almost every journal in the world as being a superior diet. The Okinawa diet is also good, but Mediterraneans and Okinawans in Japan have the longest survival or longevity in the world.
Do óleo de coco se extrai triglicerídeos de cadeia média. Aqui nos Estados Unidos é falado de MCT. O que ele acha do MCT?
Oh, medium triglycerides, or MCTs.
Yes.
There's a lot of new information on MCTs as far as providing energy to the brain. I think it's very good. MCTs, and again using coconut oil, can provide good food for the brain. And this might be beneficial in people with memory disorders.
Gostaria de saber por que o senhor escreveu o livro As 8 Leis Espirituais da Saúde e o que mudou no seu dia a dia pessoal e profissional depois de conviver com pacientes que tiveram experiência quase morte.
I encountered many people with near-death experience in my career as a cardiologist. perhaps 20, 25. I only had two near-death experiences that were not pleasant. One of them was in a barber who was also what you call a bookmaker in the United States. And his near-death experience was total blackness. Everything was black. I had a United States Marine who died on a racquetball court, and his near-death experience was awful. He was being drawn to flames, and he met a hooded man, and on the third resuscitation, he almost went into the flames, but he was told to go back. Those were the two worst near-death experiences I had in my practice. All the others I had were good. People told me of floating on the ceiling, watching me resuscitate. I had one man that told me that he wanted to go, and he was so upset with me for bringing him back that he wanted to sue me, but he had a great experience. Fortunately, he realized it wasn't his time. The most profound near-death experience, the one that lasted for a long time, was Tommy Rosa in heaven. His near-death experience was an education where he learned several laws of nature, so to speak. And we wrote about them in the book. And in his near-death experience, the lessons of love, of connection, faithfulness, vital force, grounding, self-love, purpose, all the things I preach in my psychology training and my cardiology training, he learned in heaven. Tommy Rosa was an incredible gift to me because he validated a lot of the things I was talking about on earth. Let me give you an example. 30 years ago, when I was lecturing to doctors on coenzyme Q10, they would walk out of the room. I'd be lecturing on homocysteine or lycopene or omega-3 essential fatty acids, and there was a lot of pushback. When I learned about grounding 15 years ago from Clint Ober, and I lectured at conferences, people couldn't believe it. You know, how could the earth energy heal somebody? And then the list goes on and on. But then when I met Tommy, and he went to heaven, and Jesus Christ validated the things that I was preaching on earth, it brought great joy to me. Now, even though Tommy acted as a clairvoyant, these people, even though they can help heal others with their energy, they can't heal themselves. So when Tommy saw me on television, he wanted to see me as his physician. I put Tommy on metabolic cardiology because he had a very diseased heart. He had a severe cardiac contusion, had leaking heart valves, defibrillator, pacemaker, and was severely compromised. Had heart failure and got much better on metabolic cardiology. So Tommy was sent to me to help heal him, but Tommy gave me an incredible gift. And permit me to share that. Two things. One I mentioned, where he validated what I was preaching on earth was validated in heaven. But the other reason was more personal. Like I stated before, I've been at the bedside of many dying people. Some people had beautiful death experiences. Some people were terrified. And since I've been at that in that bizarre situation, even my own parents, my father died suddenly in my arms from a dissection of the aorta, and I couldn't bring him back. My mother, who was diabetic, she died in my arms, and I did a deathing experience with her. And this is something that maybe you should tell your constituents. If you're at the bedside of a dying person, hold them, let them know that you're with them. And the important thing is to think pleasant thoughts. Once you get involved with the fear of dying, that fear can overwhelm you and control you. So now when I'm at the bedside of a dying person, I ask them to think pleasant thoughts and to look for a light. Look for the light, because as the person is passing, they're very comforting words to give them. And those are the words I gave my mother. And she passed in my arms, which was a beautiful death experience. So this is what Tommy did for me, and will do for you and your daughter and every human being on the earth. You do not have to fear death. Believe me, I fear death because I've had a lot of bad experiences with patients in terror. But after meeting Tommy, we are all going to a better place. And I'm not afraid to die anymore. Tommy met his grandmother, and he met his father in heaven in spirit form. So I just feel with Tommy's experience and all the other life after death experiences I've had, I just feel it's God's gift to me in bringing Tommy to me and bringing all those other people. But 20 years ago or 25 years ago, it wasn't a good idea to talk about life after death because it was very uncommon in books and TV shows. Now it's more common. I wrote in this book at the very, very end that Tommy Rosa is a canary in a coal mine. Remember, a canary in a coal mine was used to determine that if the canary survived the coal mine disaster, the men would survive. So at the end of the book, this is what I said. Tommy and other NDEs, because we're seeing a lot of them lately, are the canaries in the coal mine, or the messengers to all mankind. In the final analysis, we should all be asking ourselves the most important question. Why am I here? Why are you here? What is my life's purpose? When and how do I prepare for going home?
Qual a mensagem, então, para a gente finalizar, do Dr. Stephen Sinatra deixa para que os nossos amigos que nos assistem possam viver mais e melhor?
The most important thing that I can recommend to our viewers is to tell the truth at all times. If you follow your truth and you tell the truth, I believe you'll live a long life. And the reason why I say that is my experience of earthing and grounding. We realize that as soon as you put your bare feet on the ground, you get a balance of the autonomic nervous system. It's almost like when a person takes a lie detector test. When a person does not tell the truth, there's an autonomic discharge from the nervous system. And over time, that can cause problems in the body. We call it autonomic hyperarousal. When I learned that grounding regulates the autonomic nervous system, and then I realized that telling the truth also regulates the autonomic nervous system, I thought about my worst high blood pressure patients in my practice. This is only an observation. You won't read this in the literature. The worst five patients I had where I could not get their blood pressures down with all sorts of therapies, mind, body, diet, pharmaceutical drugs, you name it, these patients weren't telling the truth. They went through life as a lie. So I would say that's very important for our listeners. I can say one more important thing if you like, if we have time. Follow your intuition. For men like you and me, it's difficult for us to understand intuition. Women have it better than us. Women are the stronger sex. I believe that. However, when a woman becomes more like a man, she develops a male-oriented disease, which is heart disease. In the United States, men were developing heart disease much more than women for decades. Then in the late 1990s, women were getting more heart disease than men. That's why I wrote the book, Heart Sense for Women, because I was seeing more women in coronary care units. And what I learned as a psychotherapist and as a cardiologist was this. If you have to be like a woman, you know, act like a man and work like a dog, that's a bad scenario for women in the 21st century. I mean, women today have full-time jobs, they're caretakers for their parents, they take care of children, they chauffeur children, they cook meals. Some of them are the only breadwinners if they're divorced, and they suffer. The greatest gift a woman has is her inner voice or her intuition. But here is the problem. If the woman, in her pursuit of success, competition, working in the workplace, if she doesn't listen to that inner voice and shuts off her right brain and gets more involved with logic and reasoning. She turns off her intuition, and when she does that, I believe as a heart specialist and as a psychotherapist, she invites heart disease into her life. So women who cultivate their intuition and follow their intuition, that inner voice which tells the truth, that's the greatest gift women have. So I wanted to just share that as I learned that over 4.5 decades of being a heart specialist.
Agora uma mensagem especial para a Priscila, minha filha, que representa nesse momento milhões de crianças ou adultos que nascem com uma cardiopatia congênita, ou até mesmo aquelas pessoas que adquirem uma doença cardíaca no decorrer da vida, e que muitas vezes são desenganadas pela medicina tradicional. Eu não aceitei o diagnóstico que foi dado para minha filha, procurei alternativas dia e noite durante 8 anos que pudessem salvá-la. Atravessei o Oceano Atlântico para, em primeiro lugar, agradecer ao Senhor por ter tido a luz de criar a solução de Sinatra, e agora minha missão de vida é ajudar milhões de famílias que precisam saber que existem outros caminhos para uma vida saudável, mesmo para os cardiopatas. Uma mensagem para a Priscila.
I'm very touched by your story, and you must have suffered immensely as a parent, knowing that your child had a life-threatening illness. Let's look at the spiritual side of this. I believe that this was placed in your path because you are an excellent, outstanding communicator. You are the voice of the people for Brazil and other Portuguese-speaking peoples as well, where maybe the tragic suffering you endured with your daughter's illness now gives you not only hope, but inspiration to share with others that miracles do happen and that if you follow the truth of your heart, that sometimes there are very, very happy endings. My only caution is that if there is a surgical way out or a very easy conventional fix, like Tommy's defibrillator or a pacemaker, I would certainly entertain it. One thing about medicine that I can tell you from being a doctor for 45 years, things that we thought were dogma 10 or 20 or 30 years ago are false now. And new technologies can be developed where we can get our life back. But for now, I believe that ATP, our chi energy, our ki, our breath of God, and Tommy's experience, for now, we can rely on God's simple cures. But I will not rule out advanced technology in the future, because we all need hope.
Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much.